There was some speculation about our use of the period Warner Brothers and Paramount logos as to whether or not we were trying to make the movie seem like it was made in the 1970s. And although I think it was born out of the desperation to have just some idea, any idea, we just hit upon this notion of using the period logos just to kind of set the analog scene for how the drama would unfold. I wanted to do this very long tracking shot that takes you into Vallejo on the 4th of July. I wanted to kind of see, you know, some notion of normalcy, or, you know, just rows of houses and people going about their lives before, you know, we sort of introduced the violence. We tried using all kinds of special stabilizers to put them inside the Corvair and drive down the street, but what ended up happening was we were either kind of locked to the car and the world around us sort of shook and jiggled, or we were locked to the world when we had a gyro stabilizer and the car sort of wiggled and shook. So we ended up laying about 450 feet of dolly track and mounting the camera inside the Corvair and pushing the Corvair down the dolly track in order to get that shot. It's a little insane, but it just needed to be that sort of detached, indifferent view of that rows of houses and the people with their barbecues. There's so many things that are kind of oddly personal in this. There was an A&W drive-in restaurant that was on 4th Street in San Rafael that I remember very vividly as a child. We used to go there every once in a while for a float, but it looked very much like Mr. Ed's. And so that was sort of what was sticking in my mind. When we were trying to lay out the opening sequence and how we would see Vallejo and how we would see this period and see the opening night, I was looking for a piece of music. And originally we had cut this scene to Big Brother and the Holding Company's All Is Loneliness, which was a beautiful track, and the music really fit the scene. And George Drakoulias, who did the music supervision, came to me with some other ideas just to say, hey, we should definitely explore everything, and here are some other ideas. And we listened to some more kind of psychedelic San Francisco kind of music. And finally, we got to the Three Dog Night. It was odd, because I was in second or third grade when this whole thing happened. And I remember so vividly driving through Sonoma from Vallejo. It's an area known as Black Point. And I remember being in the back of my parents, 65 Impala, and the windows were rolled down. It was the beginning of summer, and you could smell eucalyptus, and this song was playing on the radio. And there was something about it, when I heard it, it literally transported me personally to the summer of 1969, which is, again, a purely subjective thing. And, you know, making movies ultimately is a wholly subjective thing. But I remember being just feeling, you know, very misty when I heard that music and I heard it playing over those pictures. I love the scene. I love the way Lee and Kira played this. It's an odd thing because in the reality of what really took place, they were much more knowing, or certainly Michael felt that they were much more knowing about who the person was that came in the car. In fact, he said that at one point he actually said to Darlene, I'm not getting shot for this. And we thought, it's a good line, but I don't know that we can use it because of what's about to happen. That couldn't really have somebody say, I don't want to get shot for this, and then have them get shot. It had to kind of come out of nowhere. There has been some conjecture about why we used a Mustang instead of a Corvair, because the police reports regarding Blue Rock Springs, Michael Majo said he couldn't tell what kind of car it was. It was either a Corvair or he thought a Mustang, a bronze color. So we debated it for a while, and eventually we all agreed that it would be too doppelganger-y, too ironic, too much of a Charlie Kaufman movie if an exact duplicate of the car that they were in showed up behind them. We certainly had three bronze-colored Corvairs and could have put it in there, but we just felt that it needed to be a different car. The silencer in this sequence, you know, is a hotly debated issue. In police reports, we have people who are pretty sure that they heard gunfire. But there are also people who said that there were firecrackers being lit in the actual parking lot. And when Mejo walked us through it, one time he was pretty sure that there was a silencer, and another time he was not so sure. We opted to have the silencer because it was in the police report that it was a silencer, and also to, you know, again, show that the silencer was probably homemade and not real effective. In conversations with Mejo, it was unclear as to whether or not he threw himself over the seat into the back of the car when the firing began or when the assailant returned with the reloaded gun. In the blocking of the scene, it seemed to work better that he, once he realized that the shooter was going to return or had returned and was going to continue, that he sort of ejected himself into the back seat. And again, there is no way to make a movie that's not subjective. You have to make decisions about what the behavior is, and you have to sort of work with what dramatically works.
Goodbye.
This is one of my favorite shots in the movie. It's the opening push-in on San Francisco. It was very important to me that two things be seen. One, that we see the Embarcadero Freeway that fell in the 1989 earthquake and had to be dismantled and carted away. And also behind it, one of the most important landmarks for me, which was the construction of the Hyatt Regency. Because I remember the day that it opened and my parents brought us into San Francisco to ride the elevators that went up to the Equinox. And I love the idea of seeing this cosmopolitan city, or the city that San Francisco was when I was a kid. It was a very sort of jewel-like kind of cosmopolitan oasis, and that's sort of what I wanted to get across in that opening shot.
There will be a test tonight.
This is with garage rental of Pioneer speakers for $188. Make it a back easy one in my marine. 6400 Mission Street, top of the hill, 86.
This is a matte painting that was done by Matt World. They did most of the matte shots in the movie. And again, it's very, very subtle work on the edges of the frame and the top of the frame. This is not the foyer of the actual Chronicle building. We did use the Chronicle building for the exterior, but the foyer and the elevators, it's kind of based more on my recollection of the Time Life building in San Francisco where my father used to work and when I would go visit him. Again, I saw this movie as flying in the face of a lot of things that I'd done before, and I liked the idea of doing something that was very, very simple in terms of its travel and cause and effect. I mean, really all we wanted to do was bring this one specific letter into this world. I mean, the Chronicle is a key kind of hub in the movie because it's where all the information is sort of disseminated, and it's certainly where a couple of our leads, you know, come in contact with the idea of the Zodiac. But it was written in the script. It was a beautiful sequence that was much more elaborate in that it followed this letter through the entire, you know, literally you stayed with the letter as it, and it went by people and you heard things. And it was a sequence that I would have loved to have shot the way that it was written, but it probably would have taken about 3.5 weeks. So we ended up having to do it in about 3 days or 2 days. And also I liked it being kind of straightforward. When I was a kid, a lot of my heroes were cartoonists. I used to love watching Bob Bastian, who was a Chronicle editorial cartoonist who then went to a television news program called Newsroom on a KQED Channel 9. And when he committed suicide, and I remember the day that they kind of announced on the air that his body had been found and that he had taken his own life. And I remember really feeling oddly betrayed by that because he was definitely somebody that, you know, as a 8-year-old or a 9-year-old, I used to love to watch Newsroom. And I loved the fact that here was a guy who was sort of sitting by the sidelines who would listen to what the other journalists were talking about, and then at the end of it, he would produce this cartoon. And I think my father owned a couple of them. They were just done on newsprint. marker and charcoal. They were really beautiful. And I also remember collecting some of Graysmith's. I mean, I just cut them out of the Chronicle and sort of keep them. I love the line quality, and I loved the idea of people who had to turn something out, had to churn something out day after day, and had to have some kind of salient quality. The Zodiac letters, to me, were kind of the most important hook in the movie. They were certainly the biggest hook for me as a kid. The notion that somebody was offering you an insight into their kind of psychological makeup. And there's something about the graphic nature of his writing and the way that his moniker and his brand, there was something really fascinating about that. We shot this scene, the reading of the letter, we shot it twice. The first time I was framed in a much more omniscient way, and when we cut the scene, it just didn't work. It didn't have, you didn't follow the letter, and you didn't follow the interest of, or non-interest of the parties that the letter came in contact with. And so that didn't sort of end up in Jake's hands in the right way. So we restaged it. We reshot the sequence, much to the chagrin of, a round table of very, very talented actors who put up with a lot of my indecision. And I really liked this version of it. I really liked the faces, and I liked the way that the guys interacted. Now, we took, great license has been taken with, the presence of Paul Avery, because probably, for the most part, Paul Avery would not have been in any kind of editorial conference. So we had to take the dramatic license with that in order to get him into the room and to get him part of the investigation.
Paul?
What? I cover crime in Vallejo?
Yeah, I cover crime in Vallejo.
Downey is, everybody knows, truly wonderful, but this was the first day that we really kind of got to see what he was going to do with Paul. And Avery was a guy that we didn't know much about. I mean, we talked to Toski about him, we talked to Graysmith about him, we talked to a couple of other people, but he was kind of an enigma. And when I first talked to Robert about playing him, he said, well, what kind of research can you give me? What can you? And I sort of felt maybe it was more deferential not to dig too deep into who this guy was and sort of allow it to be Robert.
Al's on the phone with the Examiner. They got the same letter with a different code.
Also, the Times Herald. Christmas. Two teenagers on Lover's Lane, both the OA. David Faraday and Betty Jensen. July 4th, Darlene Farron and Michael I think it's Mayhew. Anyway, he lived. She didn't.
The murder weapons?
Ballistics. Everything he said in the letters match. I mean, I think the Times Herald is going to go with it.
The Examiner's going, but won't go front page. I say let's go front page. If he kills 12 people, it's not our fault.
I love the feeling of the newsroom. And I remember reading the script the first time and thinking, this is not a serial killer. This is a movie. It's a newspaper story. And that gradually becomes a story about justice, or the obsession with justice, and what is justice? Where can you feel good? At what point can you let go? At what point have you got what you need in order to move on? And that's what I liked about the story.
He won't give his name.
Morty's? Anyone? Where I'm heading.
This is a shot. The San Francisco Chronicle type on the building in the background we actually added. And Morty's bar was a different bar that they frequented that we couldn't use the name of because we depicted cocaine use in it, and so we couldn't legally use the name of the bar that would have been the actual bar. One of the biggest issues that we had was we wanted to, from a storytelling standpoint, we needed to talk about Graysmith's older son, and we wanted to see him in the movie. But of course, the movie opens in August, and we decided to, even though there are no schools open in August, we decided to have him drive his kid to school.
All right, people, listen up. The cipher's broken into three.
This is one of those sequences where you see a lot of professional-looking people with horn-rimmed glasses. you know, poring over evidence and bringing their expertise. And probably it was, you know, two guys, three guys in each of these scenes, but we ended up putting like five or six just to make it, just to make the joke of you have the CIA and the FBI and Office of Naval Intelligence, and then you cut to some guy and his wife in their breakfast nook, and they're the ones who solve it.
Guy used to sit there was a great cartoonist, Bob Bastian. Now he's on public television for some reason. Paul Avery.
Robert Graysmith. Mm-hmm. I've been here 9 months.
In all probability, Avery probably never had this kind of interaction with Graysmith until much later. But we liked, again, in terms of telling the story, liked the idea of Avery sort of seeing a spark and Robert and making the trek across the newsroom to the art department to fill him in on this. And I like the idea of him introducing himself, even though Robert's a little chagrined by it because he feels he's already been introduced to him before. I love that one. It often happens. You see that in Hollywood. People come up and go, "Hi, I'm blah, blah, blah," and say, "Well, yeah, actually, we've already met." And you don't know whether it's that they didn't have the confidence that you remembered, or or you're being guilted, or we had to retouch the knuckles of of this scene because Jake's hands are very hairless and pretty. And the double that we had doing a lot of the writing and drawing had much hairier hands, so we went back in to retouch the knuckles on it so Jake wouldn't feel like we'd done him a disservice.
Oh, what dangerous animal.
Paul.
Yes, Tim.
Editorial now.
Very well.
Another letter.
I don't actually know how much of it makes any sense that they would have... I mean, obviously they would have included Avery in any kind of new letter that came in, but I don't know if he would have been one of the, you know, nine faces of the editorial direction of the Chronicle, but from a story standpoint, we needed to include him. We had to retouch this shot in order to get all the graffiti off the bridge, because there's a lot of profanity.
You know, this used to be the town of Monticello.
We took some liberties with this in terms of the setting up of who these characters were. And Cecilia and Brian had dated, but they weren't currently romantically involved. They just happened to be at Berryessa on this day, mostly because they couldn't make it into San Francisco in time. And so they were spending some time by the water. And I wanted to have a little moment that kind of talked about they knew each other, but they didn't know each other as well as maybe the setup would make the audience think. I felt that by having them, you know, cuddled together by the side of the lake, that the audience would feel that they were, you know, lovers, and that they... but I wanted to have a moment where we realize that they're not as intimate as maybe their physical proximity suggests. There's a great thing here, too, because Patrick was... he had just finished a sandwich just as we started to shoot this, because we only had about 3 hours where the light was correct, from like 3:30 in the afternoon to 6:30 in the evening. And so we started rolling. I said, "Okay, light's good, here we go." And we rolled the cameras. We had two cameras out on this little island. And he stood up and he started going through his lines, and he got a little bit of a burp, a little bit of indigestion. He has this little moment where he sort of pauses and touches his stomach. And I just thought that seemed so real that somebody would actually kind of a moment of indigestion when they see a guy with a black hood and a 45 automatic.
He's a sociology major.
Pre-law.
Excellent. When we sent the script to Brian Hartnell, who gave us a lot of insight and walked us through exactly what happened that day, one of the things that came back, one of the notes that he had, was that Jamie had written that he was a sociology major, and he explained to us in no uncertain terms that he was a pre-law major, and that that was inaccurate. And when we got to shooting the scene, the text hadn't been changed. For some reason, somebody had an old script. And so when Pell says, who's the actress who plays Cecilia, says he's a sociology major, I had Patrick, who plays Brian, correct her and say, no, it's pre-law. And which I thought was kind of amusing, however it may be sort of emotionally inappropriate. It felt to me like they were nervous and that, but it showed us that they weren't, it made them seem like friends or you know, less like they were romantically involved. They didn't know each other that well. And I loved the idea of this little digression in the middle of it. And Brad Fisher told me an amusing story. He was sitting behind Brian and his wife when they screened the movie for them, and when the scene came up, she says, he's a sociology major. And I believe it's Brian's wife turned to him and said, pre-law. And then Brian on screen says, pre-law, actually. And the Hartnells all laughed, which I thought was... Now, some people find it inappropriate that you would have a moment of laughter in this tense setting, but I sort of felt it was appropriate.
And was that thing even loaded?
It's okay. This is all gonna be okay.
Part of the reason we chose to depict the murders that we, or the attacks that we depicted, was these were ones that we had witnesses for and that we could talk to people about. It seemed like Lake Herman, which was the first actual known Zodiac attack, was just something we had. We just had, you know, stains on the ground and white chalk lines, and we didn't have anybody who could actually walk us through it. And it also seemed like the movie really begins with the letter, and the letter is really in response to Blue Rock Springs, or it's that seems to be the main thrust of the. So that's where we began the movie.
They were in a white Volkswagen Carmen Ghia. I'm the one that did it.
The thing that's ultimately frightening and compelling about, I mean, I think the reason that we still talk about Zodiac, or the reason that still that Zodiac is still, why he still sort of haunts us, is the letters. It's not really the crimes. The crimes themselves are fairly simple and by today's serial killer standards, you know, not that grotesque or horrible. But the letters are the key. The letters for me were the thing that, again, it was this idea of this ongoing correspondence with somebody who is in process. And you got to see how he, not only the manipulation of the press or the manipulation of the, you know, the public, but just his evolution, the evolution of his thinking and how he thought about himself. And so we tried to sort of make that the letters the hub of the letters, and the letters passing through the chronicle the hub of how the story was peeled.
That's Count Zaroff.
Zaroff? With a Z?
And that will be all for the news on the 20. We've got curfews in effect tonight.
There's a time reference in the movie, which is the building of the Transamerica Pyramid. And it begins in the Paul Stein, the Washington and Cherry murder. It begins that whole sequence. That's where we start to kind of see, again, that's where old San Francisco, or for me, early 60s San Francisco changes into 70s San Francisco. And so it's one of these things that we sort of clock throughout that begins to show this evolution. The cab shot is one of those moments that people seem to really remember in the movie. And the idea here was to have this sense of both detachment, you know, God's POV looking down on something that he has no control over, and also this way of you're both locked onto what's happening and powerless to change it. Most of the violence in the movie, all the bloodletting, that is to say the stabbing at Berryessa, the shooting at Blue Rock Springs, and the shooting at Washington and Cherry, were done digitally because we determined that it was going to take way too much time to get everybody all bloody and then change their wardrobe, clean them all up, and then get them all bloody again. And especially at Berryessa, where we only had about 3 hours of shooting a day. So all of the blood that you see in the movie has been added digitally. The final pullback at Washington and Cherry, when we did the, we built a set in Downey, just the curbs and the street itself and the steps of the house across the street. When we did our pullback, we went up, put a techno crane on top of a scaffold that was about 3 stories high, and we did that crane back. And I decided then that we wanted to see something that framed the lower corner of the frame. And so we added the high tension lines, the power lines, digitally, the kind of humming. And I just got to warn everybody, don't try this shot with real power lines, because if you get a technocrane anywhere near it, you're going to have real problems.
I just got to sleep.
Suspects, Negro male adult, waltz on scene.
The driving stuff, most of the driving stuff that we did some tows, but for most part it's all blue screen. It was just unfeasible to do toe shots. So we shot a lot of plates and we were able to throw the background out of focus because we certainly couldn't go to Geary Street and put all period cars in. That would have been too insane.
So why don't you?
I haven't gotten around to it.
So Washington and Cherry is, you know, in Zodiac lore, it's very famous. It's an important turning point in the case because it's the first time he seems to be killing in response to something other than whatever his drive has been up until this point. It's not a Lover's Lane killing. It's not couples. It's as impersonal as anything that he's responsible for. And it seems to be just a publicity stunt. It seems to be that he's taken his wet work to, you know, the city and has snuffed out a life at a, you know, no, it's not a busy crossroad, but it's certainly a well-populated. As you can see by the scene, there are windows, you know, within 60 feet, 75 feet of the murder of Paul Stein. And there's a chance, you know, in all of this where that somebody's going to hear him. So it is brazen, and it's bold, and it's designed to be a real kind of fuck you to the people who are hunting him. And it was a very difficult sequence to get the approval to shoot because we had to go to the homeowners association and talk to them about tying up this corner for 5 nights of shooting. In the end, it was wholly impractical to shoot there, and we ended up building this crossroad and putting up blue screens. And in, we were actually able to kind of recreate the period better by doing it completely, by faking it. And I think that in the end, the work is so good. Eric Barber and his guys did such an amazing job that I think that it flows right with the rest of the movie, and I think that people really are taken, you know, they're transported. And it's very, very, I mean, when you talk to Armin Pelissetti and David Toski, who came down the nights we were shooting, and they blessed it, said it was extremely realistic in terms of what that night looked like. Now it's a little bit brighter by, I mean, it's brighter because it has to be brighter for the movies, but, you know, it's a pretty dark scene as far as movies go. Harris Avitis, who's one of the more fearless cinematographers you'll ever meet, lit this entire scene with, I think it was pretty much 2 2Ks. And we decided at the last minute, it had been designed to be 5 very kind of static kind of tableaus that they would walk out of one and into the next one, and we would pan them. But we were going to keep the camera very, very static. And at the end of, I think it was like 2 days before we were destined to shoot this scene, I was driving along and I thought, you know what? It's the only time in the movie where we're at a crime scene with somebody who's trying to kind of glean what's happened. And so it would be fine to follow them around and follow them handheld. And so I remember calling Digital Domain and talking to Eric and talking to Ed Ulbrich. I said, you know, we're going to do it pretty much like we discussed, except it's all going to be handheld. And I heard the phone drop on the other end, and they kind of, their voices squeaked, and they kind of said, oh, no problem. We can do it. Yeah.
It looked like they were drunk and fighting. Yeah, and he had a rag. He came around the side of the car, and he was wiping stuff.
Did you get a chance to see his face?
I did. Well, sort of.
Do you remember what he looked like?
Normal.
Yeah.
Normal.
So I don't know how Carol Fisher screamed. I don't know how she handled the bloody shirt. But we sort of assumed that it would be kind of a big deal. There are people who take exception to the fact that she handles the letter, and at this point she would probably know better, and probably she did, but I wanted it to be sort of matter of fact, and that it didn't really explain itself as to what it was until she'd read a little bit of the letter. And the shot outside where you see the car pull up, you see the bus in the background, and again, that's a gasoline powered bus that we, you know, not only added the sky back into and the wires, but we also put the little stalks that attach the top of the bus to the power cables.
Right there, boss.
There's your rag the kids talked about. So you got in the front seat to tear up a piece of the shirt.
Is this on the record?
What do you think?
It confirms the Vallejo and Napa killings.
Gets worse.
Robert, you have a deadline?
What does he mean, it gets worse?
John Terry and John Getz were the sort of warring publisher and editor. You know, we had this sort of idea that it was hard to kind of dramatically show the hierarchical structure of the Chronicle. So I like the idea that you have two guys who basically come to the same conclusions but get there by very different ways. And I love how John Getz is a phenomenally talented guy. You know, has all these like little moments of subtlety where he's quietly rolling his eyes at decisions that are made. This is seen in the background. There's a television, and you see a young reporter up there from KCRA Sacramento doing his report on Zodiac, and that's Spencer Michaels, who is a friend of my father's, a friend of mine, who's somebody I've known most of my life, and we found this old footage of him. We showed it to him. He didn't even recognize himself. He's probably in his 30s here, and he's reporting on, I think it was, he's talking about San Francisco and the problems San Francisco's having with the divorce rate and the alcoholism and now Zodiac. And I thought it was kind of an interesting look at yellow TV journalism of the time.
All of you to please keep this confidential. Just go about your daily business. Thank you.
This bus stop, I chose this location because I used to live in San Anselmo on a street called Park Way, and there was a bus on Sequoia. There was a bus stop on Sequoia Street, which ran behind, and it was a little hill that came up to it, and it looked just like this. And so this is actually in Los Angeles, and we managed to find this one location that didn't have too many palm trees, and so we shot that in L.A. Now, Sherwood Morrill. Sherwood Morrill and Philip Baker Hall's portrayal of Sherwood Morrill. I mean, he was very, very professional, very renowned and lauded expert in his field. But I always felt, in looking at the Zodiac letters, it seemed oddly inconsistent. And there were certainly things about Morrill's stance on the case that I know that Toski and Armstrong had issue with. But it was never our intent to... I mean, he was obviously an extremely capable man.
We have to release the bus threat.
It'll screw us.
We're already screwed. We just went from routine cabbie shooting to mass murderer targets kids.
The fun in shooting a period movie like this was doing the period newscasts, because when you actually look back on and you pull reference for this stuff and you start to look at it, it's just insane how far technologically the presentation of the news has come. I mean, when we looked at, when we had stuff from the late 60s, you know, with Eric Severide, and where they had slide projectors behind screens with a guy at a desk and two or three black telephones, as though the news was coming right into him immediately before he went on the air, and he had just gotten off the phone. And I mean, it was so absurd. I mean, trying to kind of, you know, couch the notion for the audience that the world has really changed in the last 35 to 40 years. It was one of the more interesting sort of fact-finding excursions. This is Dermot Mulroney, who's one of my favorite people in the world, who agreed to come in and play this little part where I think he has like 8 lines in the whole movie, and he has to wear like a little fat suit because he's actually in amazingly great shape. So I wanted him to have a waistline like mine, so we made up a little fat suit for him so he could. And he's in every scene. He's like kind of got his thumbs in his belt line and is kind of sticking his little fat suit out, making people know that he's a guy who lives life behind a desk. Marty Lee, who's the character, that guy that he's playing, was actually in pretty phenomenal shape, and was a guy that both Toski and Armstrong had nothing but great things to say about. He was a very, very well-respected police officer. When I met Bill Armstrong, we flew up to Sacramento to talk to him, and we sort of laid out for him what the film was going to be about. And, you know, he had definitely moved off Lee Allen. He had given up that this was the guy. But he gave us amazing insight. And I hadn't thought of Tony Edwards until I met Bill Armstrong, and I came away from the meeting feeling that he was just so decent. I needed to find somebody who was as decent as, you know, Bill was extremely polite and politic about things that he felt that they had failed at, or things that he felt that they'd done right and hadn't been followed up on, or they didn't have the technology to go further with. But he was, all of these guys were strangely, I mean, because you would expect, if you're making a movie about a case like this, you would expect them to sort of want to have history rewritten just a little bit, or have things, you know. And there was I never for once got a feeling from Robert or Brian Hartnell or Dave Toski or Bill Armstrong that they wanted anything other than, look, here it is, warts and all. This is what we thought at the time. Here's the mistake that we made. We should never have done X, Y, or Z. But, you know, and there was this real sense of, it wasn't that they wanted to rewrite history. It's like they just wanted one more shot at being able to go over this stuff. They wanted just a little bit more time, a little more funding, a little more support. This kind of palpable sense of wanting to have seen this be tied up. And it wasn't sad. I don't recall feeling like, oh, I feel so bad for them. I felt very much like we needed to do them justice, because they still felt this was the one that got away and this is the one that didn't deserve to get away. So I didn't care so much about how the actors looked in the parts. I really wanted it to be about their persona and what they, the kind of energy that they put off. And I had no idea who was going to play Bill Armstrong. I think it was Lynn Harris and or Lorraine Mayfield who suggested Tommy Edwards. And of course, I knew his work as an actor, but I also knew him as a parent and as a neighbor. His son went to preschool with my daughter, and he, as an actor, he's like a great point guard. He just makes things happen socially, makes things happen. He's such a great assist. And so when we finally contacted him and he said he wanted to do it, it kind of put most of my concerns about where the casting was going to head in the movie. I finally kind of slept better when I'd gotten Jake and I'd gotten Mark and I'd gotten Tony and Robert, and it sort of all kind of coalesced at that moment, and I thought, this is going to be good.
Water theory?
What?
Geographically, every attack takes place near a body of water.
What's
or
water, your water theory?
Name? Lake Berryessa, Blue Rock Springs, Lake Washington.
Downey's wonderful in this scene. He's so professional and indifferent. I knew Robert, and I knew, and you know, he's obviously a stellar performer and an amazing kind of live actor. But the overall concern that I had for this character was that he had to be extremely verbal. He had to be somebody who was, you know, it wasn't that he was air quoting himself all the time, but he was, you know, I felt to me like Avery was, we talked about this a little bit, he's kind of a George Sanders character. He's a guy who is enjoying, you know, he's writing the rough draft in real time for you, and he's also editing it as he's saying it. He's going, oh, that's good, and that one's, he's sort of marking for posterity his rough draft as he goes.
Single male cab driver on Washington and Cherry doesn't fit.
Doesn't fit. So, why does Zodiac kill him?
This movie is, the beginning of the casting of this movie was over one weekend. I was talking to Jennifer Aniston about, we were talking about movies and actors that she had worked with that she just loved. And Jake Gyllenhaal was one of them, and Mark Ruffalo was the other one. And she was telling me just how unbelievably talented these guys were. And when we'd sort of finally sorted out how we were going to make this movie and where we were going to make this movie, sort of struck me that I really loved The Good Girl and I really loved Donnie Darko, and I thought Jake would be perfect for Robert Graysmith. And I was trying to think of an actor for Toski, and Toski's, there's a real sense of warmth to him that I don't think comes across in everything. All the clippings that you read about Dave Toski, it's kind of this like bogus super cop kind of nonsense. But there's something about him that was so warm. And I was talking to Jen about this, and she told me about her experience and work with Mark Ruffalo. And I'd never met him. I'd just seen his work. And so I sent him the script, and I had one meeting with him and just felt so at home with who he was. And then when we went into rehearsals, we did a read-through at my office with everybody that we could get. I don't think Brian Cox had been cast at that point, but with everybody that we, you know, we had, I think we had 25 or 30 people in the conference room. And walking out of it, everybody was like, Mark Ruffalo is, he's just so live and human and real and so not a cop, you know, and I'd seen Collateral and I thought he seemed oddly out of step in that movie because he's such a person, and I felt like he'd been sort of hampered or something but walking out of that first read through, I thought to myself, this is going to be just fascinating to watch. And he had this voice and this gait and this mannerism, the mannerism to David Toski. And there was a moment in time where I kind of thought to myself, I got to be careful that this doesn't become caricature, because it's kind of like I'd been involved in this movie, The Lords of Dogtown, and I'd met Skip Engbloom, and I couldn't figure out who to cast for Skip Engbloom. I actually wanted Donald Logue to play Skip, and I gone to see the final movie and saw Heath Ledger play him, and it's such a perfect Skip Engbloom. It's kind of astounding, the just everything they have. But and yet, for those who don't know Skip Engbloom, it can be off-putting. You know, people can kind of go, well, nobody really acts like that. And it's like, well, no, actually, there is somebody who acts like that. And so I was very concerned that what Mark was doing initially would be caricature. And it was funny to watch him, like his first two takes, you'd see him getting kind of, he would begin to sort of assimilate what it is he had to do, and he began to sort of physically apply it to what he was doing. And then by take three or four, you were seeing this person. And it was so, I learned so much watching him apply the external to what he was doing internally. And it was such a pleasure.
It's a long, difficult process and ineffective with
each other. Jake was so good with this kid who played his son. His name was Jack. And he was so, you know, for a guy who's, you know, doesn't have kids, he was so attentive and so helpful, obviously having, you know, acted as a young adult.
I kill, I don't get them.
That is fucked up.
You want to live, don't you?
This is a really interesting scene because all these people are looking at blue, televisions that are just showing blue screens. And there's nothing going on. This is one of those scenes. I love this scene. It's just total swamp gas because it's everybody just pretending to have eye contact with something and pretending to see something and have something change them or move them or excite them in some way. It's just total cinema.
I don't want to go to the gas chamber.
You won't get hurt if you talk to me.
You're not going to the gas chamber.
I wouldn't think that.
Brian Cox came to us late in the process. We were trying to figure out who could play Melvin Belli. And now Melvin Belli is he's a very famous San Francisco figure. He's part of the old guard. And he was a very fascinating guy. And I'd seen him in, you know, I'd seen him in Gimme Shelter, and I'd seen him in some documentaries. I never saw him on Star Trek, which is something we reference in the KGO sequence. But I'd never seen him do that. And we were trying to kind of figure out who's an actor who could carry the kind of, there was a certain grandiosity, but there was also this focus. You know, he had this ability to sort of concentrate beyond, you know, you could see what, you know, somebody told me that Perry Mason had been based on him and he was very much like Raymond Burr. He had that kind of weight and gravitas, and yet he was a showman. He was, you know, there was no question about it. He was, and so I think it was Lorraine, when Lorraine said, what about Ray Mayfield, who cast the movie, said, what about Brian Cox? It was like, oh my God, are you kidding? It was like getting hit in the face with lumber. You're just like, of course. And so we called him and had a conversation with him over the phone, and he decided to come and play with us.
My, you fellows certainly know how to put on a secret meeting.
I remember very specifically, I was in second grade, and I was on the playground at Isabel Cook grade school. I remember kids in my class discussing in the tan bark box, discussing that their fathers and or mothers were staying home to watch the Jim Dunbar show because the Zodiac was going to call in. It was one of the things I remember very vividly that day. And we didn't really know much about Zodiac. It had all been very much blown out of proportion. You know, there's apparently some mass murder and mass grave up at Marina Headlands. I mean, it had been, you know, this is a guy who climbed down from the trees with black cape on. But I do remember that day so well. There was a point in time in the movie where we got very fed up with shooting this set. And I remember a day shooting this sequence in particular where we're kind of like, are we ever going to get out of this Chronicle set? This is a nice scene. I like how this was laid out. This is Jamie Vanderbilt's notion of how to kind of kickstart the beginnings of Grace Smith's obsession. I like the idea that there was this moment in time where everybody had kind of where the new letter had come and everybody had stopped what they were doing, and they'd all sort of piled into this room to kind of be part of whatever was to come.
I enjoy needling the blue pigs. Hey, blue pig, I was in the park. You were using fire trucks to mask the sound of your cruising prowl cars. Hey, pig, doesn't it rile you up to have your nose rubbed in your boo-boos?
And, of course, the presentation of the first, the bomb idea, which was a big, you know, which is an evolution for, again, for Zodiac. He had gone away from stragglers and lover's lanes.
1 gallon of stove oil, dump a few bags of gravel on top.
Okay. It's a bomb.
Okay, we gotta call the army and see if this science experiment could actually work.
There was something very intriguing to me about, especially in San Francisco, which was just so often thought of as this sort of hippie, free love, drug culture stronghold, that the image of the Zodiac was this crew cut, white-walled, horn-rimmed glasses guy who looked like a postal clerk. And there was something about that that was intriguing to me, the notion that you know, the summer of love was in some way squelched by this guy who couldn't have been more a more conservative symbol. He's very 50s. There's a kind of very Leave It to Beaver kind of image of the serial killer. He was not a long-haired, fringe jacket wearing Charles Manson. He was this extremely straight-laced and conservative. Aqua Velva was the aftershave that my father used to use. So when somebody said, what should this drink be called? I think Downey, for 15 takes or something, we called it the Blue Dragoon. And then I said, no, I'll just call it an Aqua Velva. I love this scene between these two guys. I love the way that, I love the playfulness of Downey. Here's where you know, this scene where you don't direct Robert too much except to make sure that he doesn't swallow every consonant. You just want to get out of his way. And again, it's such a rare gift that somebody's able to make playful and silly and experiential what's ostensibly a lot of exposition. You know, and that's for me, acting in service of, you know, because this could be a very, very dry and boring scene, and it's lovely how both these guys, you know, look like they're trying to find a way into each other's thought processes.
He suggests are found in this site.
But there are non-letter symbols, because there's all these medieval ones.
I thought they looked medieval, too. But then I found a code written in the Middle Ages. Guess what it's called? The Zodiac alphabet.
I love that goofy smile that Jake has in that way. He's sort of proud of himself, but doesn't look like he has a lot of control over his presentation of that. It just seems very real. This was a scene that we put back in the movie just before we were to lock picture, and it had been taken out. It had been out for months. But I really felt that we needed to get an idea of Toski at home. I felt like we had him as a cop, and the scene sets up the whole basement for future use notion. But to me, that wasn't as important as seeing a guy at his dining room table poring over stuff that he's already seen 100 times.
Yeah, sure.
This is a matte painting that Melvin Belli's house, which is based on a photograph of Melvin Belli's house in Pacific Heights. And originally we had a matte painting that showed the Transamerica Pyramid under construction, halfway built. But it was a little too distracting. People's eyes kept going to that rather than to the Tudor manse.
It's difficult to hold it in check, and I'm afraid I will lose control again and take my 9th and possibly 10th victim.
Melvin.
We may have gone a little too far in painting Melvin as a blowhard, but I like the idea. There was a story that Bill Armstrong told us, it actually took place at his townhome, his penthouse, that was actually right down the street, or actually up the hill from the Transamerica building, which would, of course, been across the street from his offices. There was a story that Armstrong told us about. He received this call on some either Thanksgiving or around Christmas at some point, and they'd rushed over because Melvin Belli was sure that there was a sniper on a building across the street, and some people had seen a man and they thought he had a rifle, and so Bill and Dave Toski rushed over, and there was a dinner party going on, and they were let in, and they had a little conference momentarily with Melvin, and then they were sort of paraded through this party and introduced to people, and Armstrong said he began to be aware of the fact that they were sort of, they'd become sort of de facto dinner guests, and in Belli's sort of wanting to show off how responsive the police were to his discomfort. And so I like that notion of these guys being summoned to this place, and we fudged it a little bit, and it now happens with the letter. So Kathleen Johns. I'm not so sure how much I believe Kathleen Johns is a part of this whole mythology. I'm certainly part of the mythology. I'm not so sure Kathleen Johns picked up Zodiac, or Zodiac picked up Kathleen Johns. I kind of, I don't know. It seems very strange. At one point in the making of the movie, we were lucky enough to, both Brad Fisher and I, and we went to Portland, I think, to talk to Mike Kelleher, who's a really, really interesting man. And he's very well versed in zodiacology, zodiology. And he made a very compelling case for including Kathleen Johns. Kathleen Johns was really the end of Zodiac's ability to kill, or that it was the next evolution. And I think there's an interesting psychological look at the specter, the myth. I just don't know how much I buy. I mean, I do think it's odd that he doesn't write and talk about this, maybe because it's a failure. I don't know why it's a failure. I mean, maybe it's Cecilia Shepherd's proximity to Brian Hartnell that makes it possible for him to dispatch Cecilia Shepherd, and maybe it's the fact that Kathleen Johns is pregnant and has a baby with her that makes it impossible for him to dispatch Kathleen Johns. I don't know. It's a tough call. We had to kind of take a neutral stance on it. The incident in real life is an unbelievably harrowing and compelling one, where they drove around literally for hours, and he kept repeating his little mantra of, before I kill you, I'm going to throw your baby out the window. And she jumps from the, at one point he goes, the driver, whoever he was, the abductor, drives up an off-ramp onto the freeway. I think it's the 5. And she's able to jump from the car. And it certainly seemed we wanted to shoot. It certainly would have been. But I just couldn't figure out a way to put it into the narrative. It just seemed like it was a dangling participle, and it would have given it too much weight in order for it to have been dismissed later on in the scene with Avery and Graysmith in the stacks. So, again, maybe it was an error on all of our parts, but I felt dramatically like the only things that we could include were his terrorizing of her and then her subsequent being found by the side of the road.
Do you always go around helping people in the night?
When I'm done with them, they don't need much help.
Shh, it's okay.
Before I kill you, I'm gonna throw your baby out the window.
This is an interesting shot because I think the high praise to Digital Domain. But we went out to Camarillo and we closed down a quarter of a mile of road and we jackknifed a truck and we put Irony Sky by the side of the road and we got a 66 Ranchero and we put the camera in the back truck bed of it and we drove up and we just, because the camera's tethered, because we had all kinds of issues with where we could hide the recorder and how much light we could get on it and whether or not we could top light the truck with one of those helium balloons. The shot ended up being, we couldn't get the car and subsequently the camera far enough away from the truck to really have it sort of appear in the distance. So we ended up doing the shot digitally. We ended up doing it as a composite and shot it all on soundstage. And I think that the best compliment that's been paid that is that when Harry Savitas, who shot the movie, went into a timing session, he saw that and he said to the Peter Mavromatis, the post-production supervisor, "Oh God, I remember that shot. That was just hellish shooting that." And he didn't realize that it was a composite. So when we told him, he was like, "That's just fucking crazy." This is a montage that was put together by Angus Wall and A52. And this was never really designed to be this elaborate, or it never occurred to me that it could be this elaborate. And I knew I wanted to do a montage with the writings. I needed to get the letters in, I needed to get the masthead, and I needed to talk about the Chronicles, like, becoming the clearinghouse for all things, all communications Zodiac-related. And we knew that we wanted to have this montage, and we wanted to have a wonderful piece of music in here. And this montage was put together by, it had little or nothing to do with me. And I love reading in reviews where people say, "Oh," and then of course Fincher can't contain himself. He has to go and do this big. I remember just looking at it and going, "Wow, that's really beautiful. That's great. And I'll take all the credit for it." But really, I had nothing to do with it. This is a wonderful Downeyism. He had this little bar trick that he wanted to do in the scene, and he showed it to me. Said, "Here's what the thing is: you have these three straws, and you balance them, and you say, 'Okay, now I'm gonna, how do I pick up all three with one straw?'" And he showed me this trick, and he said, "Can I do that?" And I said, "Absolutely." 26 takes later, he was like beside himself. He was so frustrated and so fed up because we needed it to match now from the master shot to the coverage, and so. One of those great little moments of inspiration turns into the actor's albatross.
"Okay, look at this letter again, the part about Kathleen Jones. Tell me what facts he gives."
"A woman and her baby abducted."
Mm-hmm.
So this sequence, you know, again, reading about Kathleen Jones, the fact that Zodiac doesn't mention her for so long always seems very suspect to me. And I thought that there was a compelling case laid out for the notion that Zodiac. I mean, part of the beauty of his was his ability to obfuscate, and by taking credit for these other things, he was able to build a much bigger myth and also put himself in places where, had he ever been caught, he would have had some. Well, I don't know. I mean, maybe that's just justification, Department of Justification for Kathleen Jones, but I never bought the Kathleen Jones thing. I just thought she was probably extremely, I mean, obviously been through something incredibly harrowing, and the fact that the America's Most Wanted poster was right behind the interrogating officer's head.
"Bobby, you almost look disappointed."
"Chief's pulling everybody off buses."
This is a wonderful scene. These guys are, I love the idea of Toskin Armstrong going back to the scene of the Stein murder. We shot this scene, we shot a first pass of that scene in San Francisco. And it's funny, it just didn't look like the same place. It didn't look like the same house. So we ended up redoing it in Downey against blue screen.
"Has it ever bother you that people call you Shorty?
Does it bother you that people call you a retard?
Nobody calls me that.
Ah, the retard stuff. The retard, this was a joke that Jamie and I kind of concocted. This was never meant to be any disrespect to Robert, and there is no actual foundation for Avery. It was just a way of kind of humanizing his, we wanted to continue to find a way to solidify his outsider status and also just make him insecure about where he fit in this, you know, in the hierarchy at the Chronicle. Perhaps it's cruel and it's never meant to be.
Fuck, I died. Jesus. Tell me it's not a piece of bloody shit.
Sir, fuck! Oh, fucking crap!
I feel it in my bones. You ache to know my name, and so I'll clue you in.
The card. The card was a necessary function of having to get Avery to a place where he got, where Avery got a gun. And in reality, the bloody shirt arrived in another letter that was sent to the Chronicle, but we needed to kickstart this idea that we needed to make it positive for the audience and absolutely unequivocal that he had been communicated with by the Zodiac. And so, again, a little bit of dramatic license.
Riverside, I'm going to drive down to see him tonight. You want to tag along?
No, I have a date.
Really?
Who is this guy?
He wishes to remain anonymous. I wish to remain infamous.
So we're going to get a long break.
I'm looking for a Melanie.
Yes, the young
lady.
Thank you.
Chloe. This is a really, really talented actress who, you know, came in to play an incredibly thankless role and did it so, and was so lovely in it. She was a real breath of fresh air whenever we shot with her because, you know, we didn't have many days with Chloe, but she's so real. She has this great kind of droll sense of humor and this deadpan delivery that, and she just reminded me of all those girls that lived across the street from me when I was, you know, 12 and 13 years old that you never quite pay attention to, and then one day you kind of go, wow, she's sort of stunning and interesting, and she put these glasses on and that little red pendant, heart pendant, and it was just like, that girl's from 1973.
I'm working on, do you know the Zodiac?
Yeah.
I'm working with, do you know who Paul Avery is?
Sounds kind of familiar.
He's the writer that the Zodiac threatened.
Oh, yeah, I saw that on TV.
Well, I work near him, and he's going down tonight to track an anonymous tipster down in Riverside.
One of the things that we didn't count on was that it was when Jake's holding that newspaper over his head, all of the ink on the paper is getting wet, and so his hands are completely black by take three. I think we shot like 14 takes of the master. And we kind of couldn't get his hands clean enough, so we always, and I couldn't decide whether to make something out of that or, because he does shake her hand and you see his hand comes out and it's, he looks like a mechanic or something. And yes, I have been told that vodka with cream sauce did not exist as an Italian dish until the late 80s. But being a gourmand, I let it slide.
Maybe give us another minute.
Do you have any change? Oh, wait, no, wait, hold on. No, that's a penny.
This is a particularly hard scene because he's, you know, they're very different from take to take and trying to kind of consolidate. And I normally hate going from close-up to close-up, but the overs just didn't match. And they were sort of, they were brutal in terms of where the eye travel, where you pick things up. But they're so engaging, the faces. So It seemed to me like we could get away with it. I love this scene. This is originally designed to be a much bigger deal. And we follow Downey. It was a big kind of non-scare moment where he meets an informant, and we shot it a couple of different times. But it just didn't have its place in the movie, and we had to. I mean, the movie was long as it was, extremely long as it was, and it didn't seem like, it seemed like a moment where we could lose a bit of. But I like the idea that he goes to, I ultimately like the way that it's structured, that he goes down there, we see him, there's something, and then something kind of oddly not right about where he's going to meet this guy. In actuality, he went to a house, it was completely dark, and met some guy there, but it was too much like like the informant in Chinatown, so we didn't do that. I love her read in this. There's 14 or 15 takes, and she's different in each one of them. They're all great when she says, "This is the most interesting date I've ever been on." It's not sad or pathetic. It's just kind of like, well, no, I like this kind of stuff. There's a sort of Nancy Drew quality.
Robert.
Yes?
You sitting down?
Getting Robert to turn and walk into a close-up and say that line, he was so... He wanted to crawl out of his skin. He hated it so much, the notion of ending on a close-up. And I don't disagree, it's tough. But he did a great job on it. You know, I think he doesn't feel like natural presentation. It seemed staged. And so getting him to do that was a little leg-pulling to you.
What I knew in my gut, Ron... The handwriting matches Zodiac's.
How do you get the evidence out?
Ruffalo had all these great little things that he kept putting in, because Toski at one point developed an ulcer. So he has all these scenes where he's like taking the tomatoes out of sandwiches, and he's chewing. He's got Pepto-Bismol, and he's chewing Pepto-Bismol like, you know, mints and stuff. So he has all these things that are constantly happening, and I love that. He's always got some little stomach ailment thing going on.
Good to see you again, Mel.
All due respect, can someone explain to me why I'm reading about breaks in this case in the Chronicle instead of getting calls from you?
We got screwed. Dave, come on. You do get your name in the paper a lot. People talk. I don't ever talk about an open investigation, period. Okay, Ken?
This is a funny scene. I love this scene. It didn't really happen this way. I mean, it was more that they saw him and he kind of waved, but we had him come up and say, "Hey, man, can I catch a ride with you guys?" Zach Grenier, who I'd worked with on Fight Club, is a wonderful actor, and so much, he's just so droll, so much fun. He agreed to come in and do the Mel Nicolai. This is a scene that we cut. I really liked it. It's a silly San Francisco joke, but I like the fact that you have these cops and with long hair and plaid jackets coming to see the guys in Riverside who are, you know, looking at them like there they are from the pervert city. Now, Riverside, I don't know. I don't put a lot of credence in Riverside. It doesn't seem like it's part of the whole thing to me. I don't. But I liked it. I felt it was important to, I mean, if it is a red herring, then I think it's presented appropriately. Again, there were so many dead ends that led to this case being spinning out of control, the investigation spinning out of control, and this is one of them. This is, I think that the whole Sherry Jo Bates and Avery's attribution of this to Zodiac, I think was a real, it may have derailed this case for all time.
These are what Sherwood Morrow matched to the Zodiac letters?
These in the desktop, Don. This was found a couple of months later by a janitor in RCC storage.
And again, you know, trying to get back to the graphic presentation of writings and you know, this was a prop that had to be made and had to look just like the actual desktop, which we had photographs of, but we didn't actually see. Hope Parrish, who did all the props, did a lovely, lovely job with all of the letters that were so meticulously recreated. They're beautiful, stunning, and this desktop as well.
I also told him we don't think this is Zodiac.
Okay, wait a minute. You don't think this is Zodiac?
We got a guy.
And again, we don't know what was said in this actual meeting. We have... We have David's remembrance of it, and when we talked to Ken and Norlo, who was wonderful and gave us so much insight and so much of his time. And but, you know, again, this is a fairly subjective representation of it.
Now, that's something he's done before.
Look, now you have everything we have. But in my opinion, you guys came south for nothing.
Prove it, gentlemen. Prove it.
I don't care what he says.
This was filmed in Culver City. We ended up having to do a lot of digital work to take out satellite dishes, which turned out to be, when we go to scout locations, we'd say, how much is it going to cost to take down those satellite dishes? So it was like $40,000 to pay people off, send people up on the roofs, so we ended up, you know, painting them out digitally, each frame.
And Riverside's telling me I'm on a snipe hunt.
I love this. This was a scene that, you know, I really, again, it's kind of created because I think that Toski had this frustration toward Avery and they did have a falling out, but it didn't happen out in a parking lot right in front of the Riverside PD. We just replaced it here because it seemed like a good splitting off point. And Downey came up with this by himself, this whole getting this notepad swatted away and then pardon while I retrieve my nonsense, which I thought was great. We had many more scenes in the actual in the first draft where we really saw the building of these scrapbooks, you know, Graysmith's attention to his collection. And there's a Bob Wagner, the AD, and I have this rule that we never ever want to see when extras are hurrying, we never want to see anyone look at their watch. So we shot this shot, and Ruffalo comes running up the stairs, and he checks his watch, and Bob looked at me, and I said, no, 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 when Mark Ruffalo does it, it works.
Cut off all the victim's hands.
Zodiac didn't cut off any of the victim's hands.
Are you sure?
Yes, sir. Travis and
I work here. I thought this was very funny, the notion of having all these kinds of people who were so suspect, and then leading into the Don Cheney, Sandy Panzarella meeting in Torrance. I like the idea of couching. It's literally I have to meet with every lunatic who's come out of the woodwork to offer their theories. And so it's all sort of culminates in this guy telling you this incredibly hard-to-believe story that it's all been laid out for him by Lee Allen.
Himself Zodiac to mess with them.
They like messing with people.
You're positive he said Zodiac?
Yeah. I thought it was a stupid name, so I told him. He got up all upset and said, I don't care what you think. I thought about it a long time, and that's the name I'm going to use.
Did you feel like he'd been...
Had an interesting meeting with Don Cheney, who seems... He's a guy who... He's just not a bullshitter. He doesn't seem... He seems so credible. And the way he tells it to you, and of course... Things that he says are so, you know, it's so hard to, it's hard to believe. And yet when he tells it to you, you kind of go, you know, most homicides are solved by somebody dropping a dime on somebody else or somebody finally telling a friend or saying something in a bar. And so that aspect of it seems very believable, but again, the New Year's Day story was such an incredible thing that I really wanted to meet with Cheney just to look him in the eye, just to see whether I thought he was a lunatic, and I didn't. He was extremely forthcoming and seemed incredibly honest. Again, that's really just part of the circumstantial case. It's all we have. Then it is circumstantial, and we know that, but it is, you know, ultimately it is Robert's story and David's story and what they believed.
The
checked. He did. First recorded contact with the police department about Allen was in Pomona, January 10th, 1970. He just got lost in the shuffle.
Did Cheney have anything against Allen? Did Allen screw his wife or anything?
We're going to do a full background check. But I got to tell you, I like this guy.
So let's pull some handwriting samples. Hi. I talked to Sherwood. He got the samples. What are you having?
It's one of those great moments where you have an idea for a scene and you know you're gonna need coverage and the guy's gotta eat and you go, oh man, this is gonna be a nightmare. And then you come in, you shoot the master, and the master's so good and the timing of it works so well, you just go, well, that goes in the movie, that's fine, we'll move on. We don't need close-ups of anybody, we'll be okay.
Been fired for touching kids.
Touching?
Polite euphemism. So what do you wanna do?
Make some phone calls.
Are you done with the price?
Go ahead.
Did you and Mr. Cheney have a chance to look at the copies of the Zodiac letters we sent you?
Yeah. Some of this stuff is pretty creepy.
Yeah, we know.
I mean, creepy like Lee. He misspells words like that. He thinks it's funny.
Poor Tony. I think he probably had a telephone to his ear for about 6.5 weeks. On the shooting of this movie. So many scenes where he has to be hearing something that's being read to him just off camera, and he's responding.
He can write with either hand. Didn't you guys know that?
In everyday life, Allen uses his left hand. Job application.
There's a real sense of, to me, in this scene especially, of and in the latter scene that we've put back into the movie, but this, the triangle of Martin Lee and David Toski and Bill Armstrong, there's this real sense of them. It's like they want to believe and they don't want to believe. They want to keep that distance and they want to be, you know, they don't want to get sucked in. And yet they're so hopeful about finding some answer. The interrogation scene, the mat shot that opens the sequence, is actually from Point Richmond, and it's a Standard Oil plant in Richmond. When I was a kid, I think it was in the late 60s, it may have been in the early 70s, when the oil companies wanted to be perceived of as less ecologically destructive. And I remember the storage containers were painted these sort of rainbow colors. So we had Matt World go and do a matte painting. We actually moved the bridge. The bridge would actually be off to the left that scene, but we moved it so it seemed more like you were further north in the bay.
Toski and Sergeant Jack Mullinax were investigating the Zodiac murders in San Francisco and Vallejo. Please, sit down.
The interrogation scene is an interesting one because, again, it's such a fulcrum dramatically for Armstrong and Toski. And it's the really kind of the only time you have any real FaceTime with Arthur Lee Allen. And we had looked around for actors to play Lee, and we'd looked at non-actors, we'd looked at people who just had the same physical kind of type, and trying to find somebody who had... I had a videotape that George Bowert had, who was one of our kind of professional advisors or technical advisors. And we looked at this interrogation of Lee that had taken place in the late 80s, I think, maybe the early 90s. And John Carroll Lynch, who plays Lee, is not really doing an impersonation of him. He's created a new thing. And we'd talked about sort of what that would be. But Lee is described, you know, it's funny when we showed the film to Sandy and Panzarella and Don Cheney, their response was, he's much more likable. And it's funny because you watch this interrogation and, you know, the guy's under a lot of pressure. But he has this very odd way of communicating, and he's very thoughtful. He's very controlling. He slows conversations down, and you can see it feels to me like it's with the intent of buying himself some time to think about what his response is going to be, which is very smart. And, you know, he doesn't seem like, you know, Wile E. Coyote super genius. He seemed like a guy who he was fairly put upon, and so it's an interesting thing. I was talking with John Lynch, and he came in and he did a reading, and he's spectacular. I mean, he's a spectacular actor. He's so watchable and so capable, you know, so nuanced, and he can, you know, I mean, it's like he's like a you know, like all the guys in this scene, Elias Koteas as well, they're all incredibly facile in being able to communicate very subtle things. And so you can say to them, well, try this, and, you know, so it's like playing an instrument through, you know, you get to like go and whisper in somebody's ear, kind of do this, and then whisper in another guy's ear, try this, and then watch how these things play out, because they will take those directions and allow them to kind of permeate the what it is that's happening. And but it was really interesting when John, we were talking about it, and I said, I want you to try doing the scene. I want you to try doing it like a guy who's innocent. You know, you don't know what this is. You're a little bit put upon because these police officers have come, and you've been questioned before, and you've been questioned before with regards to Zodiac, and you feel you've answered all the questions honestly, and you come into this room. They're interrupting your day. They're obviously casting some kind of aspersion because they've asked, you know, your superiors for your time, and you come into a room and you sit down and you offer up to answer all their questions as honestly as possible. And halfway through the conversation, you begin to realize that it looks pretty bad. And I want you to try to sort of take it back at that point. I want you, the time that they want to see your watch, you begin to realize, oh, well, wait a minute, this could be very, very bad. And he did it. And he looked way more guilty taking that approach than he did when he was kind of playing a guy who was trying to hide the truth. So it's an interesting thing, you know, there's the perception of, there's behavior, the perception of the behavior, there's the, you know, when actors are trying to lead you to a conclusion, or when they're just obliviously in the moment, how, what the audience brings to it, what the other characters bring to it, or how the other characters point the audience. It's a fascinating thing. I mean, ultimately, this movie is just about behavior. It's about casting wonderful faces and performers, and they just talk. I mean, that's all that happens in this movie. So that was a different and interesting thing for me. It was not a place where I feel most safe. I mean, I do, you know, I tend to kind of think things through to the point where wooden Indians could show up and I could at least finish the day's work. But when you have, you know, people of this caliber and they're bringing all this great stuff to it, it's so much fun to kind of, you know, sit by the camera and watch how it plays itself out.
Well, Don's a very reliable guy. If he were to tell you something, I'd believe it to be true.
This one.
What about it?
Here, where he spells Christmas with two S's. We got a Christmas card from Lee a couple of years ago. He spelled it the exact same way. Christ Mass.
Would you still have that?
I can look for it.
Thank you. That'd be great.
Is there anything else we can do to help?
The brother said he would search Lee's apartment next time he went out of town.
It gets you around the warrant.
For the time being.
I didn't prep this movie in the same way that I've prepped other movies. I didn't do any storyboards. I didn't want to do any storyboards. I did some previs for the murder sequences just so that people could have an idea of what we were going to see, the extent of what we were going to see. But for the most part, it was kind of, I think we want to be here for this. I think we want to. And I was trying to, I mean, this movie is very simply staged. And that was always the guiding principle. It's like, we've got to do this in a way that is, you know, it's not about being meat and potatoes. It's about being, I don't want people to be distracted from anything that the characters are saying. It was a very conscious decision to, you know, we don't want any artifice. We don't want to underline anything cinematically. We want to just present behavior and see where it leads the viewer.
She was killed a day before Halloween, and you received a Halloween card.
You know, these are all fascinating pieces of minutia, Robert. It's a bit early in the day.
Paul, it's 11 o'clock, and we missed editorial.
sorry. I didn't mean to wake you up. I just thought that.
This suspect is not your Zodiac.
This sample matches the canceled checks in the application.
Mm-hmm. Perfectly.
So we've just retested the left hand. I mean, we know he's ambidextrous.
In 38 years, I've never seen anyone that ambidextrous. Both hands would have commonalities. I'm sorry. It's not going to work.
Homicide, Toski.
Elise Kitaeus. Elise, I was somebody that I had, you know, always wanted to work with. I talked with him about, I think it was in 7, going back that far, 13 years. And we'd never been able to get on the same kind of page. So when it came up for him to play Jack Mullinax, Mullinax was from Texas and he was, you know, Elias is so a New Yorker. But again, he's a great listener and a wonderful persona. So again, it tended to be more about the impression that actors left as opposed to what they looked like. So a lot's been written about this shot as some kind of flourish. But again, it just seemed to be part of the fabric of, or part of the structure of what we were talking about. We needed to have some things that were quintessentially San Franciscan that would show a passage of time. Now, this was a series of still photographs that Craig Barron at Matt World found, or maybe, I don't know, what, maybe Max found them. They were a series of stills of the construction of the Transamerica Pyramid. I think Transamerica had actually taken the photographs to document it. And we turned these over to Matt World and said, this is what we want to do. We want to do this shot. We need to show 11 months pass, and I don't know how long it takes to put up a skyscraper. And, you know, probably the skyscraper was done in late 71, so we're probably, you know, fudging things a little bit by having it. But we needed to show a passage of time, and we wanted something that had something to do with the skyline of San Francisco. And so we turned it over to Craig and Matt World and just said, you know, go nuts, give me a time-lapse sequence that shows. Now there's, you know, all kinds of things that are, I mean, that the sun moving across it is really the sun moving across it in one day, but the interesting thing, and there's probably no way that you know, panels siding, like, would pop on in the middle of the night, because chances are they're not working through the night operating heavy machinery. But in any case, the notion was one of, it wasn't meant to be, you know, let's have a directorial flourish here. It was like, how do we tell the story of the passage of time? And originally there was a whole montage, an audio montage that happened under it, where you had guys talking about Rick Marshall and guys talking about, you know, some of the other, you heard phone conversations, and you had Mel Nicolai and Ken Narlo, and in the end, it just was too difficult for test audiences to kind of follow it, and they just needed a reprieve. So we ended up cutting all the dialogue out of it and just showing the thing and playing Marvin Gaye music, which you can't really go wrong with that.
So I just asked him straight out if he thought Lee was capable of killing people.
Because of patient confidentiality.
The man said yes.
Again, you know, this is one of those meat and potato scenes where Bill Armstrong has to get a new piece of information. And again, we had police reports that talked about a meeting between Lee's sister-in-law. And when we talked to her, she did not recall it. She said there's no way it could have happened. And you know, we had to kind of go with the... We went with the police reports, and we told her what we were doing. They were, you know, the Allen family were unbelievably respectful and listened to what we intended to do, and it was never our intention to punish the innocent. And so, you know, we tried to be as respectful about that as we could with all the victims and all the victims' families. And, you know, and I do think that every effort was made to make sure that people were presented, warts and all, but that it was, you know, this was a time and a place people really wanted to do what was right.
Change like Zodiac would manifest it physically, altering his handwriting.
Which is why Sherwood couldn't get a match for mailing samples. We got Terry passed.
I don't think that any of this, whether it's a misconception that Lee Allen was Zodiac, I don't think it was, there was, I never got the sense there was anything malicious on the part of Don Cheney. I believe he believes what he said happened. And, you know, Dave Toskey believes it to this day, and Robert Graysmith believes it because Dave Toskey believes it, and that's the story that we're presenting. This is a scene that came out in the last test screening that we did in New Orleans. We showed the movie, and people just could not abide by a scene of three guys talking to a speakerphone. I this scene cracks me up. Just the conceit of it, that you would kind of get this big wrap up, and I felt like the audience needed it. Maybe they don't. They certainly didn't in the final. But I love the idea of watching how the police have to lay it out for themselves. They have to lay it out in a convincing manner. There are certain things that there's the moment in here where he talks about the weapons, and they shoot a little glance between each other, and they'll list them. They don't really have that stuff at their fingertips, but it's the kind of process that police officers go through as they compile their case, and they build their belief structures, and they have to prove it to themselves and to one another over and over and over before they're given, you know, the opportunity to go and serve a warrant or get a warrant to serve, and I like that. To me, it was a very interesting sort of tapestry of facts and circumstantial evidence.
Berryessa murder. On the day that the two kids were stabbed, his neighbor saw bloody knives in his truck, which he claimed were used to kill a chicken.
Does he have any alibis?
And anytime you can cut to a speakerphone as the Charlie's voice. I just love the idea of these guys laying it out for Charlie. And it seemed like such a 70s idea.
What name?
Zodiac. Alan wears a watch that bears both the word and crosshair symbol. And he mentioned Zodiac to Cheney a year and a half before it appeared in any letter.
John.
That's pretty good, guys.
You think so, too?
Let's take it to a judge.
This is a trailer park in Burbank that had been shot for Bad News Bears I've been shot many times as a trailer park, but we brought in this pink trailer that most looked like Lee Allen's trailer in Santa Rosa. And we ended up thought we were going to do matte paintings to take out the gravel pit that's in the background.
Hello?
And again, we don't have photographs of this. We just have what David and Bill told us about it, that there were cages all over the place and that place was in real disarray, and we don't know what the kinds of pornography that were found in the trailer. We don't know what it was, so we had to, you know, we went through clearances and 269 soulmates we could clear. So it ended up in the movie. But again, probably he wasn't interested in 269 soulmates given his rap sheet. And again, this is a great example to my way of thinking of watching how actors can, you know, it's like they say in basketball, it's moving without the ball. It's so nice when you see guys just going through a process, even though they know that they're not the object of fascination. They're just sort of the vessels by which the story is going to be told. And it's a very, you know, it's a lost art, you know, a lot of acting. This day and age is about making faces and feeling pain, and these guys they're so good at, you know, navigating through an experience and making it real for non-participants.
We found in the cab. Well, he's got the same size shoes and gloves as Z. Probably just a coincidence.
Again, all the stuff that they're talking about that's found in here is, you know, including the gloves, size 7 gloves, all that stuff's in the police reports, and all that stuff is the stuff that, of course, solidified it in the minds of Bill and Dave. And I don't see anything particularly ironic about him driving up in a Karmann Ghia. A lot's been made about that, but he had a Karmann Ghia. He actually had a cream-colored Karmann Ghia, but we couldn't find a cream-colored Karmann Ghia. And it's a problem with the high definition with Vipers. shooting white in sunlight. I remember being in my parents' Audi 100 LS driving away when we moved from Marin County in 76. Suitcases and everything, boxes packed in this car. And as we drove, I remember looking back on what was probably just south of Vallejo. I remember thinking to myself, I wonder, did they ever catch Zodiac? It was like one of these things I was asking myself as we moved away, as I looked back on, you know, my childhood in an odd way. It was like there was that thing that, did that ever get, and nobody really had an answer. So when I read the script, there was an answer to why there was no answer. It was kind of a cathartic thing. The Dirty Harry scene was, in my conversations with David Toski and with Robert Graysmith, they were a little amused by the way that Hollywood had depicted the Zodiac case. They were sort of tickled by it. I guess I didn't see Dirty Harry until I was probably 12. I didn't see it till its re-release. But I remember, because Zodiac was such a kind of a personal thing, it seemed to me it was, you know, this person had kind of crept into our collective unconscious and fucked with us for so many years, that when I saw it, when I saw Zodiac as plot device in a movie, I was a little bit appalled. And I talked to Dave about this, and he said, well, you know, he was a little sickened by how easy it was all concluded in the movies, and kind of resented the fact that, you know, people were saying to him, hey, Clint Eastwood sure did a great job with your case. And so we wanted to depict that in the theater, in this theater sequence. And the quote, hey, pal, they're already making movies about it, was something that Toski said to us, that he really felt at the end of watching it that they were ostensibly done, or that the public no longer felt a need for closure. And in some weird way, that the ending of Dirty Harry had in some way superseded the need for closure in the actual Zodiac investigation. And I thought that that was an interesting thing to kind of talk about and use that as the fulcrum for the first half of the movie and the second half of the movie, that Dirty Harry could, in a way, be the moment in time where the audience experiences a little bit of the despair that I certainly felt that. I remember as a 12-year-old watching the movie, I sort of felt like, that's it, huh? It's just, I guess in real life we don't need that same clue. It's almost better to have some sort of placebo closure than it was to acknowledge the fact that there was no real closure. So the music montage was something that I wanted to do. I mean, we'd done the Transamerica Building, and we'd shown Passage of Time in different ways, but I wanted to have a real mass culture reference in transporting us forward 4 years. And so the idea was to do this montage purely of audio of different songs, and to finally take the movie from mono to stereo, since, you know, six-track stereo only really kind of came on the scene with Star Wars. So we were moving forward to 1976, 1977, and so what I wanted to do was sort of open up the surrounds and kind of stretch the audience forward and, you know, let them know the movie is not over. In fact, this is, in some ways, the midpoint, which I'm sure elicited groans from test audiences. But I felt it was important, and I liked it as a way of telling the story. That's the fabulous Andy Walker, whose character, again, as an extra, you know, he won't work unless he has an idea, a very specific idea of who his character is. So he was playing a reporter who was breaking Watergate. He was on the phone, and if you walked past him while we were shooting, he was on the phone constantly saying, well, I think there's something to this whole Watergate thing. So that's what's going on in the background and with Andy's character. Don Burt, who did the production design, is wonderfully talented and extremely good production designer. Felt very strongly that we needed to show the passage of time in the Chronicle offices. And so and he came up with this beautiful kind of color scheme notion that we would go, you know, it's right after the Montreal Olympics, and you know, there's primary colors, and you know, it was a very kind of primary time. And so we go from the drab kind of gray metal office furniture to the blue IBM Selectrics and the terracotta colored walls and green. So it becomes this, and we also add the drop ceiling. The light fixtures themselves change. It moves out of the 60s and into the 70s. This was a scene that I loved shooting. I really dreaded it. Initially, I thought, "Oh my God, it's going to be so mawkish. I don't know how to help these guys other than to say, whatever you do, don't make it mawkish. Make sure that." I didn't know what to expect. And we went to rehearse the scene. We parked this car and turned on a couple of really simple work lights just to watch. And they were just wonderful. It was like I was watching it on screen, just going, "Wow, it's better than I could imagine." And both of them, both Tony and Mark, really find this great kind of sweet spot in how men talk to one another, how they express their disappointments, and how cops, you know, kind of, there's this honor amongst them that is unwritten and unspoken, untalked about, and I love the way the scene turned out.
The boys need to be tucked in, please, and the baby needs changing.
I'll flip you for it.
You wish.
Nobody has more Zodiac crap than you do.
There's a part of Sausalito that you drive past on 101 coming from the Golden Gate Bridge. And I don't know where Paul Avery lived on his houseboat, but I always saw it as this place. And we found a houseboat that had shingles because we had a footage of Paul talking on the back porch of his houseboat, and it was shingled. So we were just looking for something with shingles in it. And Don Burt built, this is actually shot on a stage, just the shot where they walk up to where Jake walks up to the houseboat is shot in Sausalito, and the rest of it is shot on a soundstage. But I love the idea of him, again, the conceit of the scene is that he's going to try to rekindle the interest in Zodiac of the person he considers to be the foremost expert and his hero. And he sees Avery, and Avery is fairly ruined. And we shot the scene once, and it really didn't work. There were many, many different ideas as to why it didn't work, but it, fundamentally, I think that we were just... it seemed very simple to me. I loved the notion of kind of, you know, opening Graysmith's eyes to the fact that the world just wasn't working the way that he saw it. That even the people that he thought stood for justice and justness, that there's the professional newsman in Paul Avery, that there's a part of him that sees righteousness and goodness and all that, but there's also the part of him that is a professional, and the fact of the matter is that that's not what was happening anymore, and that there was really, you know, don't cry over spilled ink, and this reminded me very much of the newsmen that I'd met with, that were friends of my father's. There was a part of them that was very much about people paying their dues or paying the price for what it is that they did, but then there was also, you know, they were fairly forgiving and kind of cold about things when they took too long. It just, at a certain point, it wasn't news anymore. And so I thought that was, although this scene probably never took place, I know that Robert went and spoke to Paul and told him that he wanted Paul to, he was trying to kind of fire Paul up, and Paul wasn't really that interested, and it probably wasn't as callous as it's portrayed in this scene, but I liked the notion of the coming of age. And then I liked the fact that Graysmith, that we see the resolute nature of his decision when he goes home to the person he trusts the most, his wife, and she says, "Where have you been?" And he says, "At the library." We really get the idea that he has not been discouraged by Avery's snide comments. And then this scene was tricky because we had to count on the audience being able to recognize Washington and Cherry. And I hope that they do.
Thank you.
This is some great wardrobe. Casey's Storm wasn't slavish to Toski's, you know, style sense, but it was this—is the sense of him, you know. And I love the bow tie and the quick draw holster.
You're busted by magic. I'm Robert Graysmith. I work at the Chronicle. I was wondering if I could buy you lunch.
Sure.
So you're a friend of Paul Avery's.
And this is a scene we shot. This scene once, and it was kind of cobbled together. Poor Mark had to take 4 bites of about 74 different hamburgers because couldn't quite get the rhythm of this. And Jake he wasn't sold that the text was correct or what the tone of his questioning of Toski. But we reshot this scene and we went back, and this is the first version of it, and the first version was better.
Okay, can I show you something? I've been doing research on the first cipher. Everything an amateur would need to create it to be found.
I love the woman who looks like Gloria Steinem in the background. A lot of times when we're shooting, I'll refer to extras in the background as people that they look like, because you can't always say, okay, the guy over there with the brown shirt or whatever. So you just go, Gloria Steinem needs to move left a little bit. And we often amuse ourselves with those little, the guy who looks like Wally Cox, or the guy who looks like whomever. Don Knotts needs to move to his left a little bit. But that was Gloria Steinem that day. There's a wonderful handoff that's made in this. And Jake does a great job with missing it at first and then understanding what it is that Toski's saying to him.
I can't allow you to help. I can't discuss the case with you. I can't give you information, and I certainly couldn't tell you to go see Ken Narlow in Napa. Narlow.
This is a matte shot that was added at the last minute. It was based on the poster that Paramount came up with. And Matt World did the final artwork for the poster. And we were looking for a shot that kind of kicked off Graysmith's going north. He's going to finally go north and sit down with Ken Narlow and insinuate himself into it or show his enthusiasm. And so we did that shot. It was all CG. Donald Logue I've worked with Donald for the first time in 1986 or 87 or something like that. We did some Budweiser commercials, and he was fantastic even then. And I actually, the cab driver that he did for MTV, I never even recognized that it was him. But time to time, you know, we'd run into each other at things, and I always remembered him because he was so kind of funny in these Budweiser commercials that I'd done. And when the opportunity to cast Ken Narlow, I was trying to think, who can we get? And so we asked Ken. I called him to tell him, "Hey, listen, we got a guy, but, you know, tell me, who would you want to see play you?" And he said, "Well, let me ask my wife." He came back and he said, "George Clooney." So I was really happy that we had Donald Logue, but I think Ken Narlow really wanted to be played by George Clooney. I don't know that Jake feels this way. I know people feel I don't give Jake enough credit. I will tell you right now that he wrote the funniest line in the entire movie. And he came in and he said, I want to try another take of this where Elias lets me in. And when he says, you don't smoke, do you? I'm going to say to him, I mean, just watch what I'm going to do. And he walked in and Elias said, you don't smoke, do you? And he said, once in high school. And I almost fell on my chair. It was because it's such a perfect epitomizing of who this guy is, that when he talks to authority figures, he immediately has to tell the truth. He's compelled to tell them, even though it's something that he's embarrassed about or he feels inside. And it's actually the funniest line in the movie, and Jake Gyllenhaal wrote that. This was about 3 days of like shooting motion control, like little... There was the motion control unit that just had this like Cooper-controlled animation stand, like cell mover, and Fluffy, who's our resident visual effects genius. He brought in this thing so we could do these little pans, and he was like, oh, I'll do it. And so we set him up, and he, I think at the end of about 2.5 days of no sleep, shooting just, you know, all these like tight inserts it was the last time he ever volunteered to do anything. I think he was cured of that. We tried as much as possible in not in a slavish homage to American Graffiti, but I did want to have, you know, real radio programs of the day that you heard in places. And one of them, you know, there's the at the beginning, there's the Gensler Lee Diamonds jingle was playing on the radio. And that was like something growing up in Marin. I mean, you always heard the Gensler Lee Diamonds jingle. You always heard, you know, Matthews, Top of the Hill, Daly City. You always had, there were certain radio, you know, Dr. Don Rose. There were certain things that you heard always whenever you were in a car, you know, and we tried to incorporate that stuff as much as possible in the backgrounds. I love this scene. This is the deep throat scene where Jake finally goes and tells Mark what he's kind of come up with. And we put Margot, Graysmith's daughter, in the baby carriage that he's brought to this meeting. Because, in real life, Robert brought his kids to a lot of places. I think he actually brought his children when he went into the hardware store to see Lee Allen. And we wanted to incorporate some of that stuff. When we shot this, we had shot the sequence once in San Francisco under the bridge, under the Bay Bridge, and it just seemed too poetic. And so we went to this place on Wilshire Boulevard, and you know, that's basically what you see is what it is. We put in some benches, and Mark gives this wonderful performance here of this kind of, he's encouraged this guy, but he doesn't know whether he's encouraged him too much, and he doesn't want to get drawn back into this thing, but he certainly wants to give him enough stuff to, this might be somebody that he can use, or that he can, might be somebody who'll stick with it. And I love his tone here. Gyllenhaal showed up this night and he was ill. He had a flu and he was at about 102 temperature, and he didn't think he could go on. And he said to me, you know, I don't think I can do this. I think we're going to have to do this some other night. And I just said to him, there is no other night. We're doing it tonight. You're going out and doing it. And he, I mean, I think in a weird way, it focused him, because he's so, not only because he wanted to leave so bad, but also because I think there was something kind of about his feverishness that focused that performance. And he's truly great in that scene.
But maybe Melvin Belli could.
He should be along soon.
The sugar cookies thing, I think, is something that Jamie came up with. He always liked to have little bits of stuff for the actors to do, you know. Would you like some milk? Can I get you this? And the how they sort of try to derail Robert in his inquiry. And I love the idea of the woman who's dusting and the woman who's polishing silver in the background. And he's getting all the information that he actually needs from people who are totally unaware that they're being interviewed and are really, you know, trying to sort of attend to his... They're embarrassed by the fact that Melvin Belli is so late. I thought that's a nice construction for... Or nice complication for scene.
Zodiac called, wanted to talk to him. I said, he is not here. He said, I have to kill. Today is my birthday. And then he hangs up. Then the letter arrived.
So the call came before the letter of December 20th. Mr. Bellet was gone for a week?
He came back on Christmas. Not a good day to work.
So he left on the 18th.
Is that helpful?
She said it.
This was our one of our days in front of City Hall in San Francisco. And, you know, all the period vehicles that you see moving in the background or don't see moving in the background, and all the people with the period dress. But I love scenes like this where somebody's just in the foreground and you get this feeling that the world is, and you never show the other side of the phone conversation. You just hear it. And it's such a great and simple, this is probably the tightest or most direct homage to All the President's Men that we have, because it's, there's that scene in the movie where Redford goes to the phone booth to talk to Deep Throat.
Did take place. Let's say it really was Zodiac. Why would he volunteer the day he was born?
Plus, again, I love Zach and his, he's just kind of fed up with everyone's theories and on what Zodiac is or what Zodiac's become or what Zodiac isn't. And I love the way that we needed somebody in the movie to just kind of go, hey, man, we did that. We went down that road. There's a lot, maybe too much time is spent in the movie talking about the roads that they have taken. But I do like the end where he says, let me give you a little piece of advice. And you know, he's got such a wonderful manner. And he's such a good communicator as an actor. This is a scene that we thought for sure would be really, really funny for people in San Francisco, but apparently the San Francisco screening, nobody laughed on the Herb Cain line. Maybe it's a joke for an older audience, but I love the notion that it's never occurred to Robert that we had a couple of things that we did in this, and I've not experience Robert as having no sense of direction, but I like the idea of a character who's like not really sure about how far away Sacramento is. I mean, in actuality, if he went to speak with Mel Nicolai, he would have had to have driven to Sacramento and be coming back from Sacramento. So the fact that he's now going to go see Sherwood Morrill and it's in Sacramento, it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. But in any case, I like the idea of a hero who's kind of, where is that exactly? You know, you have that whole scene where he's asking where Riverside is, and she knows where Riverside is, and he doesn't. But I love the notion of what's the one thing that we know about the Zodiac? He reads the Chronicle, and the way that she says it is so great and dry. I don't know that this ever happened. It probably didn't, that the phone rang and somebody said to him. But it's one of those great movie coincidences that at this very moment that he's arguing with his wife about how she should not be concerned that his name's in the paper with regards to his Zodiac book, then the phone rings and somebody says, are you the Robert Gray Smith in the paper? I thought that was funny. The one thing that Melanie Graysmith did tell us about Robert was that he ate a lot of toast, that he liked to toast. So we put in a little joke at the end of that scene where she says, your toast is burning.
Your toast is burning.
We choose at some point in our lives how to physically construct each letter.
Sacramento is not really that lush or green a place as is depicted in the movie, but we shot this in Hancock Park, and it was this lovely house that had a garden out in the back that walked where it was sort of surrounding this little well, and I just liked it. I liked the image of Sherwood Morrill as sort of green thumb gardener.
We don't know. Excuse me, I got a sprinkler.
How many suspects were cleared through handwriting?
All of them. Also the print in the cab. No match was ever found.
Is there any way that someone could beat a handwriting?
That shot took a long time to get the dolly to land just to the point where Jake was landing. And
about a month ago, a man showed up on my doorstep, very distraught. His name was Wallace.
I love any time somebody walks over to another character carrying a pesticide sprayer. I think it's a good way to, if you're going to impart this kind of backstory. Elise put a pesticide sprayer in a character's hand.
I never cleared a Rick Marshall.
This was one of those scenes where we were trying to decide whether or not we needed any more coverage, whether we needed a shot of looking at Jake, where Jake, where we are in his eye line, he's looking at Chloe, and whether we need a close-up of Chloe. But I sort of like the way that it played out in one simple. You sort of got the tension of this thing happening in the moment. And I love the way that she doesn't believe a fucking word he's saying.
Anything to you?
What are you after?
What do you got?
Hypothetically? You just named my favorite suspect in the
whole. Now, there's a lot of, there are many differing opinions about whether or not the Rick Marshall trail should have been followed if we were telling the Arthur Lee Allen Yellow Book story of Robert Graysmith. And I don't know. It seemed to me like it was imperative to give him comparison and contrast, that we needed something else for him to... We needed him to disappear down the other route, you know, another rabbit hole. We needed him to and I like the fact that, you know, Narlo has his own theory. I think it's imperative when you're discussing Zodiac that you discuss, I mean, because everybody's, nobody knows and everybody's got a favorite.
How do they know that Rick Marshall wrote the sign?
The Captain Ken Narlo placard that's on Donald's desk there is actually taken from a photograph we did, and the Mel Nicolai, that was actually taken from a photograph of Mel Nicolai. In the 70s, believe it or not, people did have their little name plaques on there. And as much as it seems like subtitling, it's based on actual reference. This is a perfect example of, you know, Don Burt's really subtle use of the drop ceiling. It's the only time we see the drop ceiling in the, or the second time we see the drop ceiling in the Chronicle. And so we made sure that we framed as many of these shots as looking up so that people would hopefully, at least subliminally, get the idea that time has passed.
If Rick Marshall is the Zodiac, I need a sample of his handwriting to confirm it. Can you help me or not?
Rick used to draw movie posters for the theater Vaughn worked at. I'll send one down.
Thank you.
This took forever to try and get this camera move that would sort of show the different K's. And it's one of those things that you look at or you don't look at in the movie and you go, well, there's no reason that should take 25 takes. But sometimes it does.
I've been to the DMV and I talked to her parents, but still nobody knows where to find her.
Mr. Graysmith. Most of the writing matches the exemplar. In a way, though, it's the part that doesn't match that scares me the most.
What do you mean?
Well, on the poster, the one letter that absolutely, positively does not match is the letter K.
You wouldn't happen to have any animal crackers in there, would you?
Unit 5, Toskin needs to call in all landlines.
This is the Transbay Terminal in San Francisco. I always loved this place. I always wanted to. We were going to shoot a scene in the, I think we were going to do the blowout, the tire blowout in the game here originally, and we couldn't shoot there, but we were able to shoot there this time and brought in the period Greyhound buses. And, you know, as luck would have it, there was a police telephone right now. We added that. But I love the scene. I just love the Kojak light and taking off. This was a scene that we added after we cut the movie together. We rewrote the letter. It used to happen in Dermot's conference room or Dermot's office where he read the... But we added the thing where the internal affairs guys wanted to speak with Toski, and so it sort of position the whole investigation into Toski.
It was tough. It was a very
difficult kind of, you know, subplot to go off on. And but it was really important. It was important to show. I know it's part of David's life that he would much rather be forgotten, but it was a part of the Zodiac investigation and did create real problems for him, for the department, for the investigation, and we needed to kind of give it its due. And I think it's important that the movie points out that he was exonerated. This was a blue feed to the, and it's an actor that we brought in and we shot in front of a blue screen and we comped him into a still photograph of the city in the background and comped him into the TV, and it was all done in shake.
Maupin used David as a character in his column. David got a kick out of it, and so he wrote a couple.
Phone acting is a really, it's a difficult thing because it's, because you are left so much to, you know, you for the most part probably don't have access to the actor on the other end of the line, and you're not, so it's rare that you can find people. I mean, oftentimes people are truly terrible in this and they have to sort of be tricked into, you know, by having them do it again and again. But Jake and Jules are both did a great job with the making it feel real.
Works at your paper. We trust.
This is the first scene that we shot with Mark and with Jake. And this is in San Francisco on an overcast day. And we shot 56 takes to get the timing of this right, to get one actor to hand off to the other actor, to hand off to the... And I think that they thought I was insane. But to get this thing to happen really simply and without any kind of... I just didn't want to have to cut between them. I just wanted them to present their what they'd been up to and what their thought process was without any... this, I think, we only did 22 takes, the second shot in the scene. But the first one, I think, was 56.
He didn't announce his murders anymore, Dave. He was just going to do it.
Do you know what the chances of us arresting someone are now? Too much time has gone by.
I look at it this way. I want to be able to cut where it serves the story the best. I don't want to have to cut because somebody fucks up a line or because the camera shakes, or I don't want to have to cut on things I don't want to have to cut on. I want to be able to cut a scene where I feel like, and so, and that can often be difficult because a lot of times, I think, you know, depending on the kind of discipline that you have or the kind of discipline that you've developed, you know, different directors work different ways. Some of them are happy to let the material dictate where it's going. And I think that that's, there are certain scenes in this movie where that was okay. You know, there are certain scenes where they're in a coffee shop and they're chatting away, and sometimes it works in one and sometimes it works in coverage. But for the most part, you know, it's the succinct nature of how they're delivering the information, and how, because so much of it has to do with making sure that you don't lead people to the wrong conclusions or the right conclusions too early, or worse, the right conclusions too late. So it's all about that parsing out of information, and so that's a difficult thing. And I think this is the second cipher, and I concur, and I think even Robert concurs that his solution in 1979 is not the final solution to the cipher. I saw a cipher solution from Vallejo PD that looked pretty good. Max Daly, who's our researcher, sent it to me, and I don't know that it's ever been... It was pretty good. It was interesting because it was time-sensitive and had everything to do with... I think it had to do with this KGO, but it was interesting. I don't know if it'll ever be. Who knows? Hopefully, though, somebody will do the legwork to either incorporate it or separate the wheat from the chaff. She's in jail, isn't that great? I love this scene. I liked that it wasn't heroic. And I liked the fact that Graysmith has no insight into his own obsession. And I felt Jake really sort of showed somebody who was torn between, I get what you're saying to me, I get what you're asking of me, and I don't know how to respond. And I don't know how to tell you how important it is, except to show you that, you know, I feel trapped in wanting to know something. And I don't even know if the thing that I want to know is the thing that will finally release me from. And I thought that was a really, I didn't want to see, you know, the age-old argument with the wife. And I thought that Chloe brought a real kind of, when she says that's not good enough, it just seemed to me like they were never going to agree on this thing. And I thought it was smart. Well, smart acting. I thought it was complicated.
Are you done? Can I go?
Mr. Vaughn? Mr. Graysmith?
Yes.
Hi. This is a wonderful scene. Charles Fleischer came in and I would never have... I would never have thought Charles Fleischer would be interested in playing something like this. But he came in and he read for this role, and Larrey brought me the tape, and she said, you got to see this. And I saw it, and we were like, well, Charles Fleischer's in the movie. This is actually a house that was right across the street from where we shot the bus stop from earlier. It's in Los Angeles, and it was an old house, and the interior of the house is exactly like this. This is a set that was built at Warner Hollywood, but it was an exact replica of a house that we scouted that we wanted to shoot in. The basement was not to our liking in terms of how it was laid out, so we ended up building a set for the basement. The basement is actually based on Dermot Mulroney's house. I don't know why I was in the basement at Dermot Mulroney's house, but I was. Oh, you know what? I saw it because Brad Pitt said to me, hey, if we're going to do this whole scene with the space monkeys and Paper Street, you should see Dermot Mulroney's basement because it would be perfect because you could build bunk beds down there, and it's like, it's this whole world. So I'd gone to Dermot's house and seen his basement, and so we decided to make the basement, Charles Fleischer's basement, looked like Dermot Mulroney's basement. And the actual house that we were intending to shoot the kitchen sequence in didn't have access to that kind of a basement. It was much smaller. So we decided not to. We decided to build this whole thing, and the notion of the organist, projectionist, film fanatic, and Fleischer came in, and he just had this great sort of... I mean, you would never think of him as being sinister. He's just kind of, he seems, you know, oddly possessed, but he's not, until he says, that's my handwriting. And there's this element, when he did it in the room, we just were like, wow, that's fantastic. It's just so, it was so much fun. And even though, and this is again, you know, whenever you do test screenings, there's most favorite scene, least favorite scene. This is that scene, the scene that ends up on as many most favorites as it does on least favorites, because people get resentful of the fact that you're throwing them a red herring this late. And I understand that, but I can't apologize enough.
I do the posters myself. It's my handwriting.
We had to shoot a lot of coverage on the scene, and I know that it wore on everybody's nerves, but to get to the different angles, to be able to have him cross over behind him, and we needed one where Jake looks left, one where Jake looks right, and depending on which side we were going to go to. So I think we shot the scene for 2 days to get all these little pieces, and drove everybody fucking nuts.
I do.
I love this. I love the idea of him feeling, because he's so polite, feeling compelled to follow somebody who may or may not be a serial killer into his own basement. And I like that as a character moment, that he just doesn't feel he can turn and run at this very moment. This is a scene, I think, that spoke really to the real benefits of shooting with the Viper. This entire scene is lit with 340-watt light bulbs. Film has its place. I think if you're making a movie in the jungle, you should. But I think if you're making a talkie movie, if you're making a movie about people yakking, it's like this is actually kind of a perfect choice. Harris, it was funny. He actually said to me at one point, you know, I noticed that he didn't have his light meter out, and I said, you know, you're not. Are you? Because at a certain point, you know, the camera is its light meter. You look at the picture and then you go, yeah, that's what I want, or I want that a little bit brighter. And he kind of said to me, and I don't think he intended it to be funny or ironic, but he said, you know, this is, you know, all you want me here for is for my taste. It's not really about being a photographer. And I thought, you're right, that's all I've ever wanted. I don't want you to be I want your taste. That's the thing that makes you great. It's that the taste, the level at which the risks that you're willing to take, the depths that you're willing to go to in order to make an image feel like something. This is a fun scene. I like the mirror. We originally were going to do this whole thing with over the shoulders, and we see him, and we pulled the door out and shot over Jake's shoulder, and Charles shows up and he spins around, but it worked so well in the mirror. And you know, again, this was not something that was planned on. It was just the mirror was there.
Thank you.
And that's on location again in LA, and that's on a set. So this is all blue screen. This is completely fake. This is Harris operating on B camera. It's a great, he really sticks that. And this is where he walks out. Nice work. And this was a crucial kind of pivot point. Some people it works, and for some people it does not. The notion that Melanie has taken the kids and has left him this note, and that note is on the back of the Linda Del Buono. But I liked it I liked the way that it works. I liked that it was in the crunching up of the thing, in his anger and his frustration, that he goes back to the thing that may or may not finally kind of release him. And anytime you get to use him, dyed rabbit's foot. So, keychain, it's always a kind of a good thing. We shot the scene once with another actress, and it was a good scene. It just didn't have, he wasn't kind of possessed enough. And maybe it wasn't, I mean, again, I didn't want to do Caged Women in Heat, but I wanted it to be I believe that this actually took place as a phone call, Graysmith. And this is probably the most contested link in the whole, because I don't think anybody, I don't know about this painting party. I don't know what, I know that Robert really believes that that's the linchpin, and it's a tricky thing, but it does lead back to Vallejo in an interesting way. And again, we're taking dramatic license with Vallejo and making something about we have somebody in the scene with him saying that doesn't mean the same thing to me that it means to you. And there's no way of being able to prove that what you're saying is true. And you know, you have Lee's brother saying he was never at this party. And you have people who can't place Lee at the party. But I think we're talking about, you know, at this point, the movie is talking about his possession, his compulsion, the thing that's going to get him to the end.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
How can you be sure? It's a long time ago. Think hard.
I am thinking hard.
It was Rick.
No, it wasn't.
It was Rick Marshall.
No.
Just say it.
It wasn't Rick.
And Clea DuVall is a wonderful actress. She was a lot of fun.
It was Lee.
Lee?
Yeah, Lee. Sounds right.
I love the idea of running up to a police department in the middle of the night saying, I need to go through your records. And there's, I think, great compassion here in Elias's face, the way that he wants to see this guy be done with this thing. He wants, just like he wants everyone to be done with it. And I think that really comes through.
I shouldn't be talking to you. You got 5 minutes.
Okay. Here. Linda states that some of Darlene's closest friends are Lee, who used to bring Darlene presents from Tijuana.
So what?
He knew her. Linda said Lee. This is Lee.
That's just one name in a file that contains hundreds. It's nothing.
Dave Toski
agrees with me.
He reminds me of Francois Truffaut and Close Encounters in the scene, the way that he's like, hey, we're really sorry. We did this about 38 times. Jake spilling that coffee. He wasn't happy about that. I like the fact that you finally get to a point at his quote investigation where when the killer calls him up at home, it's like he can't wait to get back to work. It's like, just don't bother me now. This was a critical scene because we needed to get the driver's license in his hands, and we needed to send him back to his December 18th obsession. And I needed it to come out of this notion that there could be no reconciliation. And I wanted it to be in a kind of a mature way. I didn't want it to be in a... I don't think either of these people were particularly vindictive. And I think that, you know, I think at some point in his... It was funny, we gave the script to Robert, and his only real note was, God, now I see why my wife divorced me. Which I think is kind of appropriate. And I think... In my experience with people who have these kinds of compulsive... My father was kind of this way, and he was the kind of guy who could become obsessed with a magic trick and want to desperately figure out how it was done. And he would... You'd see him in his bathrobe, like, wandering the house, mulling over in his head, how could this be possible? How could somebody, you know? And so... It was kind of that. I didn't want Robert to not have enough sense that he can't see the effect. I wanted him to be able to say, I can't have him see me like this at this moment. And for him to mean it. And I thought Jake did a beautiful job with that. And I also think that Chloe, I liked the fact that, you know, the woman who was being pushed out of his life by his obsession was able to say, okay, look, it's not in the cards for us, but I know that you have something that you want to do, and I want to try to support you in that, but for God's sake, finish it, and then get back to your responsibilities. This is taken the... There's a story that Brian Glover, who was a wonderful actor who... was in Alien 3, told me about how he was served a divorce. He was a professional wrestler, and he was served divorce papers. His wife had been trying to serve him, and he had finished, and he'd been dodging the process server, and finally he was he had just finished a match, and he was coming out of the ring, and he was covered in sweat, and the guy came up to him, and he said, Brian Glover, and he turned around, and he said, yes, and the guy slapped the divorce papers onto the sweat of his back and then walked away. And I love the idea that he shows up and we had this piece of paper that was sopping wet by the time Jake had been outside. And I said, just pick it up and just slap it on the door. And it worked well.
And he knew Darlene. It's in the Vallejo files. Bolnick said that he was your favorite suspect, that you spent 2 years on him, and that nobody ever came close. All the evidence said no. Sherwood disqualified his handwriting. The same Sherwood that drinks like Paul Avery now.
Yes. And now we get back to the, you know, the dramatic crux of the film, which is for these two guys, could there be a scene where one of them, where the neophyte runs it down for the old pro, here's what I found, here's what I believe, what do you think? And the guy says, I've always believed that. It's not provable. It's totally circumstantial evidence. And why, you know, why did you need to go through all of those things that I went through? Why couldn't you have saved yourself? And I like that idea that you know, amongst the two of them, this is where they ended up. They ended up back at this place where it was slightly more illuminated from another point of view, but it was the same circumstantial case, and it was going to be the same frustrating end. But that, you know, and I think that it's nicely drawn in the way in Jake's presentation of it, that he finally feels like, if you'll just tell me, as the person I look up to, that you concur, I can move on. And that Toski says, you know, and that Ruffalo says, I concur. And write your book, put it out there, see what happens. Maybe it'll stick, maybe it won't. And I thought that's as much solace as they were going to get, that I thought it was a compelling end to a movie. And then, because of that book, George Bauer went to Mike Mignot at the end of the movie, and or at the end of the 80s, and got an ID. Now, as we all know, 30 years hence, identifications are as suspect as they are, depending on light and faculties and inebriation and whatever other circumstances, but that in some way, you know, that other people finally believed what Toski and Graysmith believed.
Okay. Zodiac had to have known Darlene Farren, right?
Yes, because of the phone calls on the night of her murder.
Because of the Vallejo file, we know that Darlene knew a man named Lee?
Yes.
So all coincidence aside, Robert, how can you be sure that Lee Allen is a Lee from this file? Now, Vallejo is a small town, but it's not that small.
This is a nice scene. It's we shot the scene once and it didn't work out. There was a sense I really needed Jake to have become the expert. And I needed him to have the facts at his fingertips. And the first time we shot the scene, it felt like it didn't have that kind of, he didn't have the knowledge of an obsessive who's pored over something. He wasn't behind it in the same way. And we went back and reshot this. His father came down the set that day that we reshot this, and I think that gave him a little added confidence. But he nailed it on this day. It was perfect.
The prints, the handwriting.
I'm not asking you as a cop,
but I am a cop. I can't prove this.
Just because you can't prove it doesn't mean it's not true.
It was compelling, and I needed it to be compelling because it was a final kind of conclusion to their stories. And I think that people who say there's no conclusion to the movie aren't watching the same movie necessarily. Yeah, you don't. You know, we don't shoot Scorpio and he doesn't drop into Larkspur Landing. This was shot on a set at Warner Hollywood, or The Lot, as it's now known. This is actually, that's not the Castro Theater. We kind of did a matte painting. This was shot in downtown LA, and we made it look like the Castro Theater with a matte painting. This was a scene, we reshot the scene, made it a lot longer. It was much more about Jake seeing all these different faces and people in the hardware store. And we went back to this first version of it because it was a little cleaner and a little simpler. I liked the more drawn-out version, but I think it was too frustrating for audiences. By the way, in the reshoot, the calendar is not there. And this, I think with the calendar, no. I think initially this was supposed to be, anyway, I've been in so many hardware stores where the calendars are old, that when it was brought up, there was no reason to go back and reshoot this shot because John Carroll Lynch was so good in it. And we could have gone in and digitally retouched it, but that would have made 3 or 4 people happy and been boring. I think that's the first time in motion picture history that Ontario Airport has been shot as Ontario Airport. So I take certain pride in that. We devised a new kind of indifference because of digital filmmaking techniques. We can now lay track in all of our shots and paint it out later, which we ended up doing a lot of. This guy, Jimmy Simpson, he is so fucking talented. He came in, we originally read him for Duffy Jennings. Adam Goldberg ended up playing Duffy Jennings, and Adam Goldberg looks nothing like Duffy Jennings. And again, in keeping with my treatise to make sure that nobody actually looks like the person that they're supposed to be playing. But Jimmy Simpson came in, and we did the read-through, and he ended up sitting next to Lee Norris, who played Mike Mageau, or Mageau, at the beginning. And I was looking at the two guys, and I thought, you know, they look oddly similar. And so we went to Jimmy, and I said, you know, there's a scene at the end of the movie. It's not as many lines or as big a part as Duffy Jennings, but it's a critical scene, and would you like to do this, be the last face in the movie as opposed to... He said, absolutely. I said, okay, it's only one day of shooting. And he said, no problem. And he came in, and he was so great. He was so spot on.
You had a round face like this guy.
There's Bob Stevenson. Bob Stevenson, who's a great friend and has been in almost every movie that we wanted to make sure that Zodiac was depicted in each of the scenes where he was actually, where there was an eyewitness, as he was described. And so there are scenes where he's 5'11", 195, and scenes where he's 6'1", 215. And so in each of those places, we have a different actor playing him. Sometimes he's wearing glasses, sometimes he's not. And so we tried as much as possible to kind of keep with the description of the assailant as much as possible. Again, we're not saying Arthur Lee Allen was the guy.